the top 10 never fails to amaze every year. Each year, among the 18,000 or so new species discovered, are always so many unexpected ones. So it takes about 2 years until you actually accumulate all of the new species. And so the committee's work is pretty tough because we limit it to species found the year before. So we have staff and volunteers comb through journals the previous year, find as many amazing ones as they can, and then distill the interesting ones down to maybe 40 or so candidates that are then given to the international committee. And it's an international committee of experts on various plants, animals, and microbes. And they are free to also introduce other species. If there are cool finds that that weren't identified on the list, they're free to nominate those as well. And then they have the task of winnowing that list down to the final 10. The real purpose of the top 10 is to bring attention to how little we know about life on Earth. In 250 years, we've discovered fewer than 2 million kinds of plants and animals, and the best estimates are there are another 10 million awaiting discovery. And many of those will inevitably disappear before they've ever been discovered and given a name. And one might wonder why it matters. I mean, humanity has survived so far not knowing them, presumably we'll move on. And yet we're at a point in the relationship between humans and the environment that we've never seen since humans existed. Whether you want to look at climate change or the alteration and destruction of habitats around the world, changes are occurring very, very rapidly, and we don't have a baseline understanding of what kinds of plants and animals exist to begin with. So that puts us at a huge disadvantage to measure how fast they're disappearing, to recognize invasive species that may show up where they don't belong, and simply to keep track of what's happening. We need that baseline urgently. And a second reason it matters is evolutionary history. We have only begun to understand our own origins, and everything that makes us human is modified from something that ancestral mammals had, like this musk ox behind me. And everything that makes a mammal was modified from characters that other vertebrate ancestors had before, and so forth, all the way back to the original Eve species, the original single-celled organism that started the whole tree of life, and in lesser, what makes us human. And then a third and final reason to care is biomimicry, that for 3.8 billion years, natural selection has carried out endless experimentation, weeding out the bad ideas and rewarding the good ones. And the result are 12 million organisms with hundreds of millions of clues about more sustainable, more energy efficient ways of meeting needs of survival that we can learn from. But because so few organisms leave a fossil record, unless we discover them and describe them and catalog them now, we'll lose most of those valuable hints about how we might meet our own needs more in a way that's more compatible with the Earth. A conservative estimate would be that we're losing species as fast as we're discovering them. The conservative estimates would say about 18,000 species a year disappear, most of which are unknown to science. Some people think the number is much higher than that, possibly many, many thousands more. Just as beauty is in the eye of the beholder, so is weirdness and ugliness and all the other forms that things come in. Biologically, I think the one that intrigued me the most was a tiny frog that actually gives live birth to tadpoles. And that is really a remarkable phenomenon. Out of more than 6,500 kinds of frogs in the world, fewer than a dozen have internal fertilization. And of those, all the known ones either lay fertilized eggs or give birth to tiny froglets. And this was the first one that had that intermediate condition of actually giving birth to live tadpoles. One of my favorites is a spider from Morocco that, to protect itself, does cartwheels and spins at a high rate of speed on its side toward the threatening source. So it lives in open sand dunes, so there are no bushes or rocks or anywhere for it to hide. So the best defense really is a strong offense. While we're losing species at an alarming rate, there are also lots of success stories. And frankly, the 18,000 species that scientists discovered and described last year is a success story too. We now know that much more about the planet we live on. I mean, the muskox is one conservation success story where populations have rebounded. And ESF has had a couple other spectacular examples this year, bringing the American chestnut back from the brink of extinction and reintroducing saddleback tortoises in islands in the Galapagos where they've been gone for a century.